Hello, hello, hello. Welcome back to this evening on Togetherness Media. I am, as always, Anthony Powers, and you are, as always, so loved and so beautiful for being here with us. You know, this time of year, we have so many issues where it comes to finances, normally even, but this year is even crazier because of COVID and people being out of work and, you know, and businesses being closed, and so many people are stressed. And we have an amazingly insightful person here to help us deal with that stress today. We have the beautiful, intelligent, insightful, empathetic, and wise woman, Dr. Foojan Zeine. Hello, doctor. How are you doing today? Happy holidays to you.
Thank you. Thank you. I'm doing great. Happy holidays to you and everyone who's with us. It's getting exciting. Yes. Holidays coming. Yes. And yeah.
It's beginning to look a lot like Christmas. Yeah. So today we're going to be talking about financial stress. And I know a lot of people are going through it right now, especially this year, because of everything going on, you know, less work, or maybe they've been home sick with COVID, or their businesses have been closed, and they're just trying to figure out how to keep their sanity when their finances aren't exactly the way that they want them to be. So we would love to have this conversation with you to help people out dealing with these issues.
Financial pressure is one of the hardest pressure. It affects every part of us. It affects our relationship, our mood, our physical body. A lot of people get body ache, especially in their back when there's a financial conversations that's happening for them. It definitely is a downer because there's an anxiety. And sometimes if you are going through this struggle, you tend to just go into all of the mess that is there, and sometimes an element of, you know, powerlessness is there, and hopelessness shows up for us, which is really, really, you know, it creates a lot of hardship for us. And the anxiety of the future, what's going to happen, because many of us have had skills, a particular level of skills that we have in order to move forward, particular level of resources that we have been used to, you know, we've set up our, the standard of our life in a particular way when, you know, that's not there. It's shifting all of it. It's going to be hard. And one of the other pieces, Anthony, that is there, financial ups and downs brings us a lot of the sense of failure, and therefore brings a lot of shame to us. Yeah. It's unfortunate, but that's the reality of it, what it does. It's not, doesn't mean that we have failed, but somehow it has the feeling of it as if I should have won, or I should have been better, or I should have. And then that brings a sense of shame. It's one of those pieces that people don't talk about. People don't share with each other how much money they have, or, you know, it's just not appropriate. And then even trying to tell people that you don't have it and you need it, there's an aspect of, oh my God, am I going to look like that? I'm less than. And then that piece brings a lot of shame to us. So with all I said, then what is it that we can do? Anthony, it's getting creative. Yes. Really, really trying to get creative. When it all fails, is how do you try to get creative with resources, with changing the things that we've done in a particular way, to look at the things that we've had, but not necessarily needed, but they were there because we had the opportunity to have them and gain them. And yes, there might be a grief letting them go, but it's almost like reprioritizing and reshifting a lot of our value of what was important financially. What are the things that are the most important that we have to put in? Writing up a list that says, okay, these are the priorities. These are a must. I can't live or survive without them. You know, maybe rent or electricity bill, or phone bill, you know, some of those things which are essential and they have to be on top. And then, you know, we put the list as less important, or I like to have it, but I don't have to. And so we write up the list, and then the top part that it's a must, like it's a non-negotiable must, then we start finding resources for those in order to make sure that those are available and we got that handled. And then we go to the next levels and see which ones, you know, we can let go. It's okay. We don't have to do this right now. It doesn't mean that I don't have to do it for the rest of my life. It's just I'm going to reshuffle them, and until the next level of, you know, the income is going to go higher, I'll you know, shift those. Get creative in income. There's always two ways to handle. Bring down your expenses and raise your income. That's the only way to do. And so let's get creative on both sides parallel.
Okay. Beautiful. What do you suggest people, like, I know a lot of, you spoke about shame, and that's such a huge part, especially in this materialistic world, this materialistic time that we live in, where even like social media and the regular media glamorizes wealth and material objects so much. You know, you can't get away from advertisements, like, you know, trying to sell you new, beautiful things. What's a great way for people to deal with the shame and remove that from their lives, and the egotism of not being able to have the new shiny things, or just lacking in the things that they normally would have?
First of all, let's look at it as a temporary thing. Let's not look at it as for the rest of my life, what's going to happen. Yeah. Even if, to this date, you have the same circumstances, it doesn't mean that in the future it has to be, if that's not your choice.
Yeah.
So let's look at it temporary. Let's not generalize it to the rest of our life. The second part is that the value of knowing that, you know, having the shining object, having the green cash, having any of those things are only part of your value. They are there. It's only a skill. If you don't have the skill, or you've had this skill, but life changed, environment changed, and the same way that you used to gain the skill is no longer going to get you. For example, I work with someone who they worked with their body. They worked in construction and they utilized their body all the time. For some reason, they, you know, they got into an accident and they ended up in a wheelchair. So they knew how to make money, but the way that they knew how to make money just wasn't going to work anymore because circumstances changed. So now he had to learn online business. In creation of an online business and how to do it. And yes, he, you know, redid his skills and figured out. And yes, there was a time that he had to allow for himself to learn this new skill to start building the revenue again. And after about a year, not only he was making money, he had his son making the same, you know, money from it. His son brought his other kids who were in high school and started, you know, selling. So he created an online business out of, you know, his garage that was making much more money than what he did before. But he had to say, okay, I can't make my money the same way that I did. And to let go of, that's the only way that I'm going to make money, right? So money, it's only, let's say, the result of a particular skill. That's all it is.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You either have the skill, you don't gain it. If you used to have this skill and that skill no longer works with that, learn another skill. Get creative in the way that who you are can create some results out there for yourself. The minute that we shut down our creativity, everything stops. The minute that I go into I can't and I don't know how, and then you stops there, it's when we stop. And if you look at it from a skill-based and not a character-based, or that it has to with me, or I'm not good enough, or there's something wrong with me. So if I strip all of those belief systems from it, there's no reason for shame. Shame doesn't even show up. It just
One thing that really struck me when you were saying is that people oftentimes see their hardships and what they're going through as just, if you look at it in a different way, see it as an opportunity to try something new and for even to have even better blessings. Sometimes, like the way what we were doing may dry up and may stop working because we were too comfortable in that situation And it's time for us to expand into something new and greater that we may not have expanded to if our other situation didn't dry up or, you know, freeze up. Is that one way that you deal with people when you like try to make them focus on, okay, but that's no longer there, but what opportunities are opening up for you now? Because you're no longer doing that, because you have more time to try something different.
Exactly. Absolutely. I think where people get stuck is in the grief of what they've lost. And as long as you just sit in that grief, then obviously, you know, it's going to go down lower and lower. It's not that we don't go through a grief. That's a normal process. But the point is that beside the grief, acknowledging that I'm going to go through the grief, but beside that, start creating on a parallel process the new environment with the technology that's going to go on, with the robotic aspect, with the everything that's going to go with the internet, with the, you know, artificial intelligence. There's a lot that is going to change. I was listening to many of the news, and it's like, okay, you know, these manufacturings are going to close out and a lot of these people are not going to have a job. And then side by side, suddenly in the news, I hear, you know, that UPS and Federal Express are actually hiring 28,000 people as drivers and people who are supposed to do. So you could see like one labor job leaves and then another one starts, because this is just a matter of retraining yourself, having your eyes and ears open into what's the next level that I can retrain myself or take what is skills that I have and reshift it to that. There are many people who started, I've had even professional people like, you know, pharmacists and some of these people where their pharmacy went out because there was something going on with their business. And then they started doing Uber and some of this driving. And then they started getting so good at it, they were making a lot of money per month on it. So it was more of not getting stuck somewhere and getting creative and reshifting those visions so that you can be out there and looking at the opportunities. Where does it stop us is when we go sit in our shame and in our grief and we get caught in there and our eyes get closed. And obviously with finances, when you do that, the more that you stay there, the more you're going to get yourself into a hole.
Yeah, the stagnancy will drop you down lower. So for people who are feeling this depression and who are feeling this stress, do you have a technique or something that you would suggest that can help, you know, clear their mind enough so that they can get back on the horse? You know, sometimes people just need something to remove the stress, like a little activity or some kind of way to get so that they can reset themselves so that they can go out and seek these new opportunities or think about these new opportunities so that their minds will be as clouded with the stress and with the shame and with the doubt and with the fear.
So one of the things that I ask people to do is to go ask 5 to 10 people of their friends and family and people who know them about what do they think they're great at? What is their best skill? What is their best attribute? What is it that they see in them that, you know, they might not see or may not give value in that way? Then I want them to sit down and go back and look at their life, even from childhood till now. What was it that they were passionate about? What is it that if they didn't have to worry about money at all, that if they had all the time in the world and money, that this is what they would wake up in every morning to do, something that was their passion? So we got two lists right now. And then the third one, I want them to go back through all the childhood and come back with all the skills that they have. Something that they're really good at, natural at. Like, you know, some people are great with their body. Some people are great with their mind. People are, you know, great with making fun out of stuff and creating humor and fun. Some people are good presenters. Some people are good, you know, drawers. But they're just naturally, that's part of them. So and start writing all the list of things that they've done, which there were skills, but they never put in, you know, kind of like a value on them. And then write that three skills. Then bring all these three lists together about what other people thought you were good at, what you think you're good at, and what is it that you're passionate about. And then you kind of like combine all of this and you get a better idea now to what it is that is your gift, right?
Yes.
Now, start looking at what are the structures of companies, jobs, things that are out there that you can subscribe to, send a resume to, start doing whatever it is that you need to do. Because there's always a structure out there that already offers this, and you can move into, you know, those types of companies. And begin talking to friends and people about opportunities that are out there. Everybody knows somebody. And, you know, you get in because everybody knows somebody, because somebody has a friend who has a friend who has a friend. Utilize those opportunities. Because you have these three lists, you can go to friends and family and people you know and say, this is what I'm good at. So please do, you know, show me, do you know anybody who needs any of these skills? And so I can, you know, I can go connect with them. And that's how you ask for help. You ask for the your community to support you. It's different when you say you go to a community and say, I need money. And yes, there are people who have the capacity to give you money, and they will. But if you you can't create a system for yourself, you can go to the community and ask for money and pay your bills. But if you haven't taken the steps in order to create, to become self-sufficient in that, the next month you're going to go do this. Then the next month you're going to go do this. And at one point, people... you only have a reserve that they can offer you, and at one point they're going to say, sorry, I can't anymore. And then the shame and all of that comes again. And then it's more like, no, from right beginning, yes, if once or twice you need something, obviously your friends and family can be there. But that can't be a system for you. You got to create
It's not sustainable.
Exactly. So you got to go after really creating the sustainable concept of how to be out there and live your creativity in a way that creates a result for you financially.
One thing that when you were talking about getting the list, one of the many things I always tell people is, I'm not saying forget your day job, but always remember your daydream. So many times people, and that's one of the biggest issues with what happened with COVID, because people started identifying themselves with what they do, like, you know, like they started seeing themselves, okay, I am a janitor. No, you are a person that does janitorial work. I am a server at a restaurant. No, you are a person who serves at a restaurant and who works at a restaurant, but who are you? So many, like, and then like people lost their identity because they had started identifying so much with their 9-to-5s. And I think that was another part of the stress, is that people had to refine who they were and redefine themselves in another way at a deeper level instead of just their 9-to-5 jobs. Would you mind speaking a little bit about that, about the identity crisis that a lot of people are dealing with when it comes to this financial stress and these times?
I think cultures create that type of identity where, you know, one of the things we do, especially in the Western world, is that the minute we see each other, we ask, what do you do? In other cultures, they don't. They're like, you know, how's your family? Who's your family? And then they, you know, they have it based on the family system that they have and they're part of. That's what it builds. But in a lot of the Western world, the first thing we do, even in, you know, small gatherings that we get together, the first information we ask is, what do you do? And therefore, the identity of the person gets really related to the career that they have or the job that they have and the achievements that they do create. That becomes part of their identity as a productive human being and as a successful human being. And I've even seen, like, even if a lot of women who decided to be homemakers and that's their job, that's their career, and 24-hour career. If they became a stay-home mom and wanted to actually raise their kid, that's a 24-hour job, actually. But they will sometimes, you know, they say it with a shame, like, oh, I'm a homemaker as if I don't have a career. And part of it is like, that is the hardest career, and that is the most important career that you have. So there's a part that, yes, our career can be a window about who we are and the skills. But remember that we're not getting fixated in that window. All that is a form of our expression. That's it. Yeah, it's one form of our expression.
Exactly. That's why But the question I always ask instead of that is, what is your passion? And that's a question that people don't get asked often enough. And that's a question that will actually be more to the root of who they are as a soul and as a spirit. Because people, and also it'll make them stop and think, what is my passion if they don't really know? Because that's what actually tends to make people happy in the long run. Well, Doc, we're almost out of time for our segment today, and I thank you so much for being here with us. Do you have any last words of wisdom that you would love to partake upon our viewers here on Togetherness Media?
I just want everybody to know that this the hardship that everybody's going through financially due to the COVID, it's a temporary concept. And it's more like create a sustainable path for the temporary aspect. And then this is a time also for you to look at the bigger goals that you have and create a system for the bigger goals that have and opportunities that will show up when, you know, this whole, you know, the vaccines will come or, you know, things will change. And look at the opportunities that you have right now, whether it's, you know, getting support from the government at this point when, you know, there are availability for it, getting support from friends and family, coming together with other friends and family and surviving through the system. But it's also a space where you could get really, really down to what is your passion and creativity. I've met so many people through the past 10 months that they have opened up that area for themselves where they've really, like, you know, worked hard and found their passion and they've actually put it through. So it's a time to reflect, it's a time to create, and hang in there. It's gonna be great.
Yeah, it's gonna be okay. You know, one thing I just thought of that will also help people is sometimes even when you don't have the act of giving, even of time, of time or just old things, giving, even when you don't have, makes you feel so, so much better. So for people out there who are stressed about finances, think about the people who still have even less than you, and just give, go out there and, like, if you don't have, like, you know, give like old clothing or give time or maybe volunteer at a soup kitchen or something like that, will actually help you with your stress, because it'll help you put life into perspective, and it'll also let you see that that for the grace of God or the grace of Source or whatever, we could all be even an even worse situation. And as long as we're of sound mind and sound body, or as close to it as we can in these days, we are truly, truly blessed. And we are truly, truly blessed to have you on, Doc. Do you want to close us out with a holiday song? You want to sing us a holiday song before we go out?
You a happy holiday song. That's I don't You're... even remember. Jingle bells, jingle bells, jingle all the way.
Thank you so much, Doc.
Happy holidays.
Beautiful. Happy holidays. Love you so much, and we'll be seeing you soon. Thank you so much for your wisdom, for your time, and for your beautiful insight and advice for all of us here on Togetherness Media.
Thank you. It's been great to be with all of you, and happy holidays to everyone who's with us, and enjoy your holiday. And just give the gift of yourself and your love to everyone around you.
Yes. Beautifully said. Beautifully said. That was Dr. Foojan Zeine. We are so grateful to have her on the show. We're so grateful for y'all for coming out and watching wherever you are, all over the world. We love y'all all over the world. And this is Anthony Powers. We have some amazing shows coming up. We got some music. We got Annika Kuhlander coming in soon doing her music show. Love, Line, love, Line, love, love. All kinds of beautiful love music for y'all. Be divine. You are loved. I'll be back on Monday.